Hey everyone, this is Matt Perez with SolidBox, and today we're going to look at creating a product with power surfacing. Now, there are lots of videos out there showing you how to use different tools and how to create different products, but I just want to put my own spin on things. So the thing that we're going to be taking a look at today is a side view mirror of a car. I don't have drawings, I don't have blueprints, I don't have sketches. I want to keep it as open as possible just to show you how to use the tools, how to manipulate the shapes, and ultimately how to work with these different tools that you have in power surfacing to get the result that you want. To get started, I have a new blank part file and I'm going to use create box. Now there are lots of different primitives. You might decide that a cone or a cylinder is closer to the shape that you want, but we're going to be focusing on the box for now. The first step whenever you're creating a primitive is to define its shape. Now we have some length, width, and height, different combo boxes here that we can change the value of. Now, because I know we're dealing with the mirror, I'm going to shrink it down in terms of the height and the width. I'm going to do a 10 by 5 by 5. Gets us a little bit closer to the final mirror shape. The next thing we have to determine is how we want to split the model up. Now, it's always a good idea to keep this as simple as possible. Now, of course, we're going to have to split this up at some point, and I know how we're going to have to split it up, but we want to be careful. We want to look at the options we have. So to get started, I'm going to leave all these set to 1. The next option I like is midplane. Now, whenever I'm working in SolidWorks and I'm starting a new design, I do my best to center it around the origin. It makes it much easier when you have to use standard planes, axes, create different geometry. You don't have to do as much work in order to locate and center things. It also helps when you're trying to make use of symmetry. Make sure that you understand the midplane option, and if you're working in a file that has nothing else, it's always good to start at the origin if you can. The next option we have is this rotation offset. Now this will rotate it about an axis that's normal to the plane that you're working in. In this case, the top plane. So we'd be rotating about the Y axis in our standard coordinate system. Now, it doesn't really do anything for us in this case. It just kind of messes up our standard view. So I'm not going to do any rotation offset. You can determine what plane you want to start on. In this case, we're going to start on the top plane. I'm not too worried about it because, again, there's nothing else in this file, but the top plane allows me to use the front view and the side views to make it much easier to work with. Then we have the options for viewing. We can display vertices, edges, the surfaces themselves or the faces. We can also determine how we want to display the overall project. We can display just the control mesh. We can display the control cage around our sub-D, or we can put the mesh on our sub-D itself. In this case, I'm going to start off just showing the control so we can see how to work with it and how this might make it a little bit easier. All right, once we say okay, our new edit power body feature is created and we can start working with it. The first thing I want to talk about is the selection process. Automatically, you have all types turned on. This means that you can select an edge, you can select a face, or you can select a vertex. That means if I drag a box, I'm going to be selecting the vertices in the front and the back. Now that box is only going to select things that are completely in it. So you see that we've got all 4 vertices here. If instead we want to look at just edges, I can drag a box and I can grab all the edges in that selection or undo my selection. If I want to look at just faces, I can select just faces or I can drag a box. And again, anything that's completely encompassed in that box will be selected. For now, I'm going to turn all types on. The next thing we have is some more selection options, different tools, different ways to expand or shrink the selection. For instance, if I grab a face and I want to expand to the next set of faces and on, we can add or shrink that selection. In this case, it's not really going to do much for us, but there are a lot of different options here. If you need more information on those, I highly suggest you check out the help file, which you should have already done when you first installed the software. It goes over each one of these options and each one of these tools. Next, again, we have the viewing options. These are the same things that we saw when we were creating our box, but the important one here is the zebra stripes. Now, of course, there's no curvature on our model here, but we can take a look at this, and we also have transparency. If you're working with blueprints or drawings or any images in your file, then this transparency is going to come in handy because then you can see through the surfaces, through the faces, and you don't have to worry about trying to match things up. We also have a triad section and an advanced section. Now I'll be getting into the advanced section as needed, so we're not going to talk about anything just yet. All right, the first thing that we need to do is manipulate the shape. And I know we're gonna need at least a single subdivision in here. And there are a couple ways that we can do this. The first of which is holding down the A key. Now this A key, again, everything was in the help file, but if you expand the selection instructions, you'll notice that additive mode is the A key here. And there's also some other options within here. As I hold down the A key, when I get close to an edge, you'll notice that I now have an edge that I can split up my model with. For instance, I can put an edge right there and it's sectioned the entire part of my model. If I hold the A key and put it over here, again, I've sectioned the entire part of my model. So now as I look at this from the front, if I drag a box over, I get these four points here. As I look at it, I can manipulate, I can scale, I can rotate, I can change the model however I want to. Now in this case, I'm going to go ahead and change my view so we can really get an idea of what we're looking at. So now you can see that we have this control box over the entire model, and we want to start tweaking it and getting our shape. So to do that, I'm going to start with these four and I'm just going to manipulate them. Now you see you have this nice control that pops up. When you grab the arrows, they're going to move in a single direction. If you grab in between the arrows, it's going to move in both directions. Now, as we rotate around, you'll notice that this is in 3D, so we can pull and push. We also have scale options. We can shrink or stretch. We can also rotate. So I want to undo everything I just did to that model and start from scratch. So I'm going to start by selecting these four sections and I'm pulling them down. Then I'm going to select just the end and I'm going to pull it down as well. We'll do the same thing to the bottom. And remember, we have a lot of freedom here. You don't need to get stuck with the original shape that you started with. We can start pulling and pushing, and if we don't like it, we can grab points, we can pull them back and make more of a normal shape, more of what we're expecting to see. So as you can see, we're pushing and pulling. Now it's important to note, I'm currently just working with the vertices. It's a very different process when we start manipulating edges. If we grab an edge and pull it out, you can see that it has a different change as opposed to just a vertice. We can also grab a face and we can pull the face out, and you can see that it has a different change on the surrounding geometry. So very important to keep in mind what you're pulling and what you're tweaking. All right, now we've made a shape looking at it from our front view. Now we can get it as close to the shape that we want as possible, make it nice and rounded. Maybe we want to pull this end in just a little bit, pull this bottom edge up. All right, so this is a nice kind of standard mirror shape. It's not too fancy, there's nothing too exotic about it. We can pull and push and we can get it as close as we want. And then once we're okay with it, let's move on to another view. Now, as we look at this from the top view, you might notice that this rounded edge on the back, it's not really gonna work for us. So if we rotate around, I'm gonna control select these faces. Now it's important to note that you can also hold down the shift key, but the shift key will not let you deselect faces. Whereas if you hold down the control key, you can deselect and reselect faces as needed. Now, once I've selected these back faces, this is gonna be where the glass is placed. I need to make this a flat face. I have two options here. I can select weight and I can manually change the weight up to 100, or since I know that I want a hard edge, I can use the hard edge option. Now all of these tools are available from your right click menu and also your S key menu. So if I control select these faces and I hit my S key, I can then use the hard edge option. And you see it pulls all that out, and now the edges along this are purple, telling me that they have a weight value. If I look at the weight, it's weighted at 100. If at any point in time I want to go back and change that, I can select all the edges and I can manipulate to another value. In this case, I want to keep it at 100 and keep that nice, sharp, crisp edge. So as we look at it from a top, we have a very different view now. Let's start grabbing some vertices and start changing the shape of the mirror. So as we pull and push, you can see that it's now taking shape. It's starting to look a little bit more like a mirror. If we want to make it a little bit thinner, closer to the end, take a look at it from our front view. All right, if we want to section this up anymore, again, we can hold down the A key, or we can make some edge selections. For instance, if I double click in the center of this edge, it's going to select the edges all the way around the model. and then I have the insert loops option. Now, insert loops is nice because we can add multiple loops at the same time. We also have the option to do things like spread them apart or squish them together. By going plus or minus in this percentage, we can also move them up or down the model. So in this case, I'm just going to add a single, and I'm going to add it directly to the center of the model. So as we look at this from the side, let's say that we wanted to tweak the shape a little bit and push it in. And then from the top, we wanted to tweak it and push it in. Now, if we wanted to add a little bit more style to this, we could control select these edges and maybe add a hard edge or manually change the weight to something like 75%. Now, if we view the cage on our sub D, we have a little bit better idea what we're looking at, but sometimes it can be easier to turn off points and edges. So now you can see we have a harder ridge in the center of our model. If we want to change that, we can control select these lines and we can maybe soften it up. Instead of 75, maybe we want 50. And again, we can turn on and turn off things. At this point in time, since we're looking at the model, let's go ahead and take a look at some of our viewing options. The middle option down here in the advanced section is for sectioning. We can do sections of our model. We can display them in multiple directions, for instance, X and Y. Can add multiple versions, and this gives us a very good look at how the curvature is displayed along our model. So this gives us a very good idea to take a look at how the shape is forming, because obviously we're working with the fewest amount of vertices, edges, and faces as possible, so adding a lot of section lines can sometimes be very helpful. We can also do a cutaway where our section lines still stay, but we're actually cutting away the model. This may help us edit the model by cutting away and working on geometry in certain areas. All right, let's go ahead and turn off our section, turn off our cutaway, and go back into editing our model. At this point in time, everything looks pretty good, but we still need to add the stock that goes over and connects to the vehicle. Well, we have a few different ways that we can do this, and the option we're going to look at is extrude. But first, I need to split this model up. And there are several different ways that we can do this. As we're looking at this, let's go ahead and look at it from a bottom view. We could again hold down the A key and add a line or an edge wherever we need to by manually moving it up and down. We can select edges and then use our insert loops option, but you'll notice that insert loops add it between an individual edge. Now this is going to produce problems for us with other faces. Potentially, not always, but in most cases, you're going to want to avoid doing something like this and splitting the model too much if you can avoid it. So in our case, let's go ahead and use this option and let's spread them apart a little bit. So you can see that as I do this, it changes the shape of the surrounding model. Now, the last option that I want to talk about is the insert edge. You can manually draw an edge if you need to modify the shape of your model. So as you can see, I was able to manually draw those edges in there and add them just as if I was using the insert loops or the A option, but containing them within a smaller region. Now that we have this face, once we select it, we can use the extrude option. Now there are a lot of gizmos displayed on the screen when you're using extrude. There are some options to change the scale. There are some options to twist the model. And then there's this option here that changes the amount of divisions or subdivisions that happen within this extrude. We also can manually control these as well. So if you, for some reason, change the scale or you change the angle, you can go back and manually change those. As we're looking at this model, we're going to go ahead and pull this down a little bit and give us just enough information. And I'm going to go ahead and scale it down 50%. Once I say OK, with that face still selected, I'm going to add a hard edge. Now you might be wondering why on earth this mirror would look like this. We want to pull it over to the side here. Well, I'm going to go ahead and select my edges. I'm going to go ahead and rotate them and drag them off into space. So now I'm getting it a little bit closer to where I needed. Now you will also notice that the shape looks a little bit funny. Well, let's go ahead and drag a box around this and let's scale this in both directions. This might give us a little bit better result. But as we're looking at it from the side, this shape isn't really ideal for a mirror. Let's go ahead and select the upper and lower edges. and let's scale them closer to each other. Then we can select the side edges and scale them apart from each other. This can give us a more aerodynamic shape. Of course, you can also manually grab these edges and manipulate them, or the vertices as needed. If you need to pull a more regular shape, or you just need a different type of control over the face, you can go ahead and manually grab them and drag them as needed. Now, in a lot of cases, you will get a more triangular shape as you get closer to the vehicle. All right, so as we're looking at this from the front, maybe we want to pull this back just a little bit. I'm going to grab these vertices and pull them back closer. And I think that's a pretty good result here. So at this point in time, I'm going to go ahead and say OK. And you see that we have a warning, faces with more than six sides. If I say no, these faces are highlighted. Now you'll notice that these faces are the area where I added that division, where I manually added those lines in between. So I'm going to go to Insert Edges. I'm going to draw from here to here, and you'll notice that it doesn't let me do it. It doesn't let me section the model up that way. That's because it's going to produce an error. So instead, I'm going to draw from this edge up to this corner, say OK, and then draw from this edge down to this corner and say OK. Now we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sides. Let's go ahead and say OK and see if it allows this. Now it's converting this region, and now we've created our surface. If I select this, you'll notice that I'm able to sketch on it. Because I added that 100% weight to the edge, it's made this a face. Let's go ahead and go to our features, go to shell, and let's just shell this model. All right, everything's shelled. Now, because we added that hard edge to the back, for models like this, you will have to be careful to make sure that the geometry on the inside is exactly what you wanted. But so far, everything looks pretty good. Everything's nice and smooth, and because we did make this a face that was flat, we can now sketch on it. This is a very handy feature within SOLIDWORKS. Plenty of times you can make complex surfaces and not actually have a planar face, even though you need one. So now we can do things such as extrude these up to next and combine them with the body. At any point in time, we can go back and edit the power body and make changes. For instance, if we decided that this edge needed to be out a bit farther, can make a little bit more aerodynamic shape. Or if we decided that this face, or maybe even this face, needed to rotate slightly, you can see that we have a drastic effect on the shape of the part. Once we say OK, rebuild the model, and everything updates properly. There's just one last thing I want to talk about, especially since we talked about sketching on faces. Under the Advanced section, the far right option is Alignment. If we want to make all these faces a plane, we have this iron option. We also have options to specify a plane within the SOLIDWORKS model that you want to snap points to. So very handy, especially if you're dealing with mirror type features. In this case, we can go ahead and just double check to make sure that all the vertices lie on a plane and make sure that we have a flat face. We can say OK, go back to our SOLIDWORKS model, and now we have a fully parametric feature that we can start modeling. Any changes that we make can all be trickled down from this power body. So that means that anytime you need to make a drastic design change to the shape, you can rest assured that the feature tree is all based on that original shape. Makes it very easy. More importantly, the feature tree is really small. We didn't have to add dozens of sketches and features and different surfaces in order to get that shape. It was all done with one single feature. Very handy, very robust, very powerful, and very easy to use. So thanks for watching. If you guys have any questions, please let me know, Matt@mysolidbox.com, and I'll see you next time.